You're listening to The Science of CX. My name is Steve Pappas. I'm known for my relentless pursuit of all things customer. Across my career and also in my six startups, I've had to learn how to make decisions in business that customers really respond to. Let's spend some time together and help your business soar, grow, and accelerate. Well, welcome everybody to another episode of The Science of CX. Today we've got a great show for you. My name is Steve Pappas and I'll be your host. Today we have a guest, and our guest is Martha Brooke. Martha, welcome to the show.
Hey, thanks, Steve.
So let me tell everybody a little bit about Martha so you kind of have an idea as to how Martha figures into the science-based research approach to customer experience. Martha founded Interaction Metrics in 2004. She's a certified customer experience professional and holds a black belt in Six Sigma. So she's dangerous around customer experience. So she's worked with her team of analysts. Martha brings objectivity along with a sense of curiosity to a variety of customer listening methods. Together, they measure missed opportunities that companies and their customers may have in the course of doing business together, and shows clients really the specifics around how to improve on all of those things. So to spur critical thinking about customer feedback and customer service, Martha leads nationally recognized conference sessions and workshops. She also shares analysis of customer experience and surveys through her blog. We'll talk a little bit about that later too, and we'll point you in the direction of how to find out more about Martha and Interaction Metrics. Her blog is syndicated through Customer Think and other portals, and she's frequently interviewed on topics such as the pros and cons of Net Promoter Score, which we've talked about before, but we're going to get a different scientific take on some of these things. So I want to say welcome to Martha, and hopefully we will be able to pick her brain a little bit because she's done some great things and worked a couple of .coms, Lucy.com and food.com, as well as she's consulted for Nike and Adidas. So Martha, I hope you can strap yourself in because we've got a great show, and I know we're going to ask a lot of questions of you. So let's get started.
Yeah, thanks. Okay.
So I think we were going to talk today about customer listening. And maybe we could start right off because our listeners really love to get tips and tricks and valuable info that they can start thinking about with their own businesses. So is there a tip right off the bat that you could provide?
Sure. I'll go with two tips. One is I'd encourage any listener to download our 5 Best Practices Customer Listening ebook. It's on, you can get to it from a contact form or almost any page on our website. But what's really helpful about this ebook, and it's a 3-minute read and not promotional. What's really helpful about it is that it sets the 5 Best Practices for Customer Listening and gives you questions to ask your team about, are we complying with the best practices? And one of them is, of course, you know, are we objective? And objectivity from a science perspective is, this is replicable data, this is non-biased, it's totally neutral data, and it's representative data. So I think a lot of people buy into this idea of objectivity, and maybe they know that definition of objectivity. But in the ebook, it actually turns that to look at what is an example of an objective question and what is an example of a non-objective question. And the example that's shared in this 3-minute read is it's a question that we've all seen many, many times. And so we're just taking that question, kind of turning it on its head and making it objective. So that would be one tip is just, you know, if all you have is this minute to listen to us, and I hope you listen to this entire podcast, but if you only did one thing, I'd say download the 5 Best Practices ebook. The second thing is, since I think we're going to talk about surveys, right, and verbatim analysis. I would say if you were going to do one thing with your survey, it's eliminate the word cloud. And the reason I would say that, and we'll talk more about that, but the reason I'd say that is that word cloud that's so ubiquitous, it gives you the sense that you've done something with your verbatims and you 100% have not. So those are my two tips.
I agree with both of them, and that's a lot of value to get us started. So let's step back a little bit, right? Let's think a little bit about how do companies get this data in the first place? Is it all by surveys?
I think surveys are the most prevalent way that companies listen to their customers. And then in rank order priority, I'd say the next most common is probably mystery shops. Certainly that would be true of consumer-driven companies. And then I would say contact center monitoring, although I don't think enough contact center, robust contact center monitoring is done, because those contact centers are such a great research lab to hear what customers are thinking. And I know, Steve, you definitely subscribe to that point of view. So I would say then after that, I'd say the customer interviews and focus groups. So there are medley methods, but surveys are for sure the most common. I'd say all those methods have different pros and cons. Some tend to be easier to extract quantitative data than others. But as we continue on in our discussion, you'll hear that I think all data has to be quantified to be at all useful.
Yeah,
to a company. Yeah,
definitely agree. And thanks for noticing that I'm a big proponent in using your contact center as your internal focus group, as your target of some of your employee surveys. And you're right, because I probably walk in and out of about 100 contact centers a year, and I notice that yes, they're QCing and QAing many calls. I don't want to say all, but generally they're random. But the goal about all of that is predominantly for coaching purposes of the agents themselves. So it tends to be on the side of training, Delta training, and additional coaching. It's rather than using the data from the calls, they're starting to do that. Some of them are starting to do more speech analytics, and they're starting to take it. But a lot of the call centers that I've been in at least in the last few years, that's what all the QCing is done for. I personally think, and I encourage every CEO and every C-suite to get down to the contact center, double check in as much as they possibly can, but sit there and interview agent after agent, because they know the pulse of the business. And that is an internal focus group. When you can't necessarily set up a true focus group, or you can't get all of the data, you also want to kind of bring in the what are we hearing data and get to that too. But I completely agree with you, all those methods. So maybe what we'll talk about next is, you were saying, you were talking about CX, and in CX, there is a boatload of data that we really need to address, and there is structured and unstructured data. Maybe we could talk a little bit about that and what we need to do about it.
Sure. Well, I'm glad you brought that up. Basically, all of customer experience is fundamentally unstructured, because customer experience is like any experience, right? It's comprised of their visual cues, their kinesthetic cues, olfactory cues, it's auditory. We approach experiences with expectations based on what happened a half an hour ago in our lives, what happened with another company that's maybe similar or not so similar. So there's always this overlay of personal history at play. In other words, it's messy and complex. That is experience. For instance, have you had a recent customer experience, Steve?
I've had many. And lately, because of the way things are going in the world, I notice things with a different perspective. So I noticed the difference in outdoor restaurants that have been popping up, that some towns or counties are allowing normally inside restaurants to be outside in the parking lot and set up things. So just recently, I had a wonderful experience at an Italian restaurant that is normally an inside place, but they really thought through how to how to create the ultimate experience when all things are really tough. And they had created a dance floor type of parquet flooring in the parking lot. And they'd stacked cord wood all the way around this tent, a beautiful tent like you'd see at a wedding. Right. And in the kind of the parquet dance floor that you'd see at a wedding, an outdoor wedding. But the wood was up about 4.5 to 5 feet high. But it just created this ambiance that just felt like a very homey feeling. So there's a lot of things happening, but that's the good side. And then we've had some not so good too.
Right. Okay. So that's really interesting. You're talking about ambiance and you're talking about the dance floor, the association with a wedding. Where does that fit on the Net Promoter 11-point scale? Do you know, it's like,
right.
Really, what I heard when you described that was exactly my point, that it's an experience and it's comparative and there's a lot of things going on. Like, you love that visual cue of the cord of wood. To you, it was rustic. It meant that they planned the experience. It wasn't just a random, how can we sell and transact more faster with this customer and get them on their way. So I just think that it's very important to dwell in this idea of customer experience is messy, and it's, again, my strong argument that we have to start there in order to render the customer experience accurately, but then we need to structure that data so we can quantify it and make sense of it, because a heap of unstructured data does not help companies improve, right? So, for example, we have a call-based mystery shop program that we've been running since forever, and one of our medical clients recently shared with me a report that they'd received from another mystery shopper, and it was all narrative. It was all blah, 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 blah. And, that's fine, but the CEO needs more than that, right? It's like, what are you going to do with the blah, 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 blah? The CEO needs to see a number, and he needs to see, or she needs to see that number going up. So it's important to start with the narrative, but you can't end with the narrative and expect that you're going to make meaningful change.
Right, right. And you've got to be able to make decisions. And these days, those CEOs have to make split-second decisions, so they definitely need the data with them. I completely agree with you on that point, too. So I guess in the surveys, if we go back to the surveys, we should look at those as to, are they structured or are they unstructured?
Right. Well, I mean, usually they're both. So they start with an experience, it could be tech support or repairs or customer service, or I recently bought something from your website. And then the survey will have a few rating questions. So that's something like, how likely are you to recommend, or how satisfied were you with the agent's expertise or their courteousness? And you have an 11-point scale like Net Promoter, or a 5-point scale, and maybe it's a Likert kind of scale. And the reason to do those rating structure questions is they're a quick, easy way to impose a number on the data. And again, my critical argument is that's really important. Unless you can quantify the data, you can't get action items in rank order, priority order. So that's the structured part. And then most companies will add, well, why did you rate that way? Or how could we improve? So they're allowing for some of that messiness by giving the customers the chance to explain in their own words what the experience was. And so that's where there's sometimes problems, because they've asked these questions. So the company is sort of acknowledging that there's something beyond their rating questions. And yet, what are they going to do with that data? Right.
Right. So those are the verbatims, right?
Yeah, exactly. And so, many companies are just not making enough use out of them. They'll toss the verbatims. They'll just allow them to accumulate. They'll do that word cloud thing because basically for free and in a minute, they can upload their verbatims and get a picture of them, which shows how frequently a word is used. Or they might read them. Like the CEO of California Closets was recently interviewed in an article about Net Promoter Score in Fortune magazine. And he said that he reads the verbatims every morning because he finds it grounding. And I couldn't agree more. Reading the verbatims, and I really applaud that. It's just that that doesn't wind up with something that's quantifiable that helps you to move forward. There are three things you can learn from verbatim, Steve. First is, what is the customer's language? And sometimes the customer uses words in a different way than your company does. And the marketing people, and to some extent the service and operations people, can adopt that language in a way to make things easier. Maybe it's using their language in terms of answering problems or explaining something, or it might help the website design. So you get a sense of how do customers use words when they're describing their issues or what's good about the company. So that's one thing you can learn from the verbatims is what's the customer vocabulary. The second is, are there topics that customers are talking about, thinking about, that would be helpful to get into your next round of surveys? And the third is those root causes. Why do customers feel and think the way they do? And sophisticated companies then take that information and correlate it with their satisfaction, customer effort, or net promoter outcome scores. So there's a lot to be gained from the verbatims. And we just have to then talk about how are you going to get that gain, right?
Right, right. So, well, let's talk about, what do they do? What do companies do with these responses now?
Right. So again, like a lot of companies just don't do very much. Now, what's coming, they word cloud or toss them or whatever. Okay. But now what's really in vogue right now is, and you alluded to this a little bit with the call centers, is, speech analytics, but in the case of verbatims, it's text analytics, right? So it's AI-driven text analytics. And I'm a big believer in AI-driven text analytics. It's absolutely great. But there are a couple of things to acknowledge about AI-driven text analytics. The first is, for the AI to be really useful and really good, giving you nuanced information, it has to be based on research intelligence to begin with. Like actual researchers need to set up the classifications, and researchers need to monitor to make sure that the AI is spot on. But there's definitely a role for AI-driven text analytics when it comes to huge data sets. But you do need a huge data set, A, to make the investment in AI worthwhile, but B, so that your AI has enough verbatims to learn from. Like, that's the promise of AI, is that it's able to learn from itself. But that requires a very large, consistent database. Like, think, I'm sure The Gap would successfully, or maybe Expedia or Hilton Hotels could successfully use AI-driven text analytics to help them move those verbatims forward. So that's one, I would say, like very in vogue and positive way of dealing with verbatims. But again, with the caveat that you want some research intelligence feeding into it and kind of working a little bit side by side. You don't want to just let the AI run, because then you don't know that it's giving you the most important information in the best possible ways. But the reality is that many companies don't have these large, consistent data sets, right? They're small or they're mid-sized companies, and they don't have a large enough database for AI to learn from, and they might not have the budget to afford an AI approach. And the other thing, and this definitely feeds into my company's wheelhouse, is B2B coming. We do consumer work, certainly in medical, but we do a lot with B2B, and I have yet to find a B2B verbatim data set that works well with AI. And maybe it's because the B2B data sets that we're working with are just so extremely geeky. But what you find in those B2B data sets is, you know, really divergent topics and really arcane language. And so it takes research intelligence to actually make sense of those verbatims. Does that make sense? Yeah.
Yeah, it does. And I'm wondering, you know, for the small, I mean, our audience is made up all over, you know, they're all sizes. So there's small, medium, as well as there are some Fortune 500s that listen to us too. And, you know, will this scare them off? Do you think the small, mid-sized business, the ones that have been struggling lately, do you think this might scare them off? Or is there an evolution that they could look at for doing something like this?
Well, I think they could be employing research intelligence. You know, maybe, you know, if you're small and medium-sized, you know, maybe you have only hundreds or thousands of verbatims per month. And, I mean, I can provide a few tips and tricks around how to apply research intelligence. You know, maybe would that be helpful to sort of describe how it works?
I think that would be great. Yeah.
Okay. So basically what research intelligence is where you have a team of researchers who agree on a coding framework, and usually to arrive at that coding framework is a lot of iterative. It's a lot of discussion, and that's why you need a theme and not just a guy or a gal in a room working on, you know, the verbatims. But it really requires that discourse to arrive at what's a framework that from multiple perspectives, we all kind of agree this works. And then the researchers go to work coding that data. And what that means is they're setting out a classification system. So for instance, the first classification is almost always, is it a substantive comment or not? Like, is this gibberish or is the customer actually writing something that makes sense? Okay, so that's the first, and it's usually pretty easy, although not always just like a flash with a B2B company. Sometimes there's a reading it, because you don't want to just throw something out as not substantive because you don't understand it right away. Okay, so there's the first classification, kind of like almost think about taxonomy, right? Like there's the flora and the fauna and the mushrooms. Okay, so there's the first. Is it substantive or not? Or maybe. Okay, so that's the first level of coding. And then you might look at is the comment about how to improve which department? Is it an improvement or a maintain comment? Okay, so that's a classification. And then you might get into, and which department is this for? Is it for repairs or tech support or customer service or marketing? Like, which department are they saying you need to maintain or improve? So let's say it's the repairs. You need to improve the repairs department. Then what are they talking about? Then maybe they're talking about the report that repairs generates and that report is too vague. And then for the further level of classification, so now we're into the species, right? And the species could be, it's the repairs report for XYZ product line. And so by imposing that structure, there's something really brilliant and beautiful that comes out of it. Now, you actually have a way to take that unstructured mess and turn it into quantification in rank order priority. And I would add one other thought, which is what's, you know, again, the team is so important at arriving at the framework, but it's the team, because I was recently asked this by a client, well, isn't this subjective? And I was like, no, actually, when multiple analysts are arriving at the exact same code, you know that you've removed the subjectivity. Right. And when multiple analysts still, at the end of the day, can't agree on how you'd code something, we have to put it aside. It probably wasn't substantive, or it needs a whole different coding framework, right? So I guess I'd say get a team, have them work out classification frameworks, and then there is a fair amount of labor in just like going through and coding and then turning that into, you know, a report that shows, again, quantification of the themes. And then, you have a way to work on that information. And going back to something I was talking about a few minutes ago, correlate it with your net promoter customer effort scores.
Interesting. And this would all work with AI too?
Well, so it should, you know, if a company has invested in AI, you want to see some research intelligence working side by side with the artificial intelligence. So some companies, they're arcane, they're B2B, they're small, they're medium-sized, they're not going to really fit with a good AI solution, and I'd say just go with the research intel. Other companies, they've got these large, consistent data sets, and I highly advocate an AI-driven approach. But I think there should be research intelligence working side by side to make sure you're extracting maximum meaning.
Perfect. Perfect. Well, Martha, I'm just looking at the time, and the time flies when you have such an interesting subject. I'm sure we could talk for hours on this. But, you know, kind of interesting. A thought came to mind when you were describing all of this as to how they could do it. From my own education, I had an uncle that owned a lot of businesses in the late 50s, 60s, and 70s. And on Saturdays, he would watch me, and we would travel to all of his businesses. And it was kind of funny because I used to wonder, why did he go to the cash register and look for the pad of paper? And then after I asked a few times, he used to tell me that I ask the people that pick up the phone or greet the customer coming in, what they were looking for, why they called us, what works, what doesn't work, and what could they do to become better. And I'm just thinking that that's kind of the beginnings of a very manual version of what you're talking about, but, you know, what the old world business people probably did, and maybe he was way ahead of his time, but he used to take that data and use it to get better with his customers.
Oh, I love it. So he was a researcher. He absolutely was applying what we call research intelligence. Right. And I love that. It's like, it's the curiosity, and it's, it's the drive to improve, right? It's both of those married together. I'm truly intellectually curious, and I truly want to improve, both for the integrity of my business and for the well-being of my customers. I love
exactly.
That.
Exactly. He was very old world. If you could picture a 5'4" gentleman with the paperboy hat on. Aww. But he used to always carry around the little tiny notebooks we used to get in school to put our homework on. And he had the smallest pencil behind his ear all the time. And he used to lick the lead of the pencil and write things down as we left each location. And little things like he would mystery shop too, because I would take it from him afterwards when we were in the car, and I'd look at it and it'd say, didn't tip his hat to the customer. Because back then, remember, you had to tip your hat, you know, thank you very much and tip your hat. And it was just, it was the little things that I remembered in the six startups that I've had, and in every business, is it's all about the customer.
Right, right. And it's all about having that intellectual curiosity about what's really going on. The only thing I take issue with is that he licked the lead of his pencil.
I know. It was so weird, but that's the way they did it back then. Martha, this has been an absolute joy for me to get time with you and to really, you know, hear some of your takes. So I hope you'll be a guest more often, too.
Oh, thank you. Yeah, well, you know, science is my shtick. So when I first learned about your podcast and the science of customer experience, I said, we've got to talk.
Exactly.
We've got to talk, Steve.
Exactly.
Yeah.
So once again, where can people find you and you know, get some more information?
Sure. So it's interaction, like we're having an interaction, metrics like the number, metrics.com. Or you could just Google on that and we'll come to the top for interaction metrics. I love LinkedIn and I'm trying to use it more. So if you do download our 5 best practices customer listening ebook, by all means, drop me a line on LinkedIn. I'm the only Martha Brooke associated with surveys on LinkedIn. So you should be able to find me that way. And I really like the conversation. I like finding out what you know, what other companies are doing with their research programs and customer experience, and what other people are seeing with customer experience, and where the opportunities lie in customer experience. So just I'm always open to the dialogue. So yeah, by all means, check out our website, link me in. Those are all good ways to find out more.
Sounds great. Martha, thank you very much for our time together.
Thank you, Steve.
Thanks. And you have been listening to another episode of The Science of CX. We'll see you next time. You've been listening to The Science of CX. My name is Steve Pappas. I really hope you've enjoyed this episode. And if you have, the highest compliment that you can give us is to subscribe, rate, and review The Science of CX. Thanks, and we'll see you in the next episode. And now, a word from our sponsor.
Panviva has 25 years of empowering customer service, and we have deep expertise in how people actually use information from our roots in learning and performance. We offer accurate, consistent information on demand to every channel. Most relevant knowledge at your people's exact moment of need. Integrated, streamlined internal processes. Systems that deliver memorable and remarkable customer experiences that boost customer retention and loyalty every time. Knowledge that extends across your entire digital landscape. To learn more, visit Panviva at www.panviva.com.